Welcome, world, to the 7th Annual Inclusive Business Forum. My name is Mike Debelak. I'm the Executive Director of Inclusive Business Sweden, your host for the event today. And I'm very excited to welcome you here from wherever you are around the world.
I'm sure you'll agree, 2020 has been a crazy year for all and a very difficult year for many. Some said we're all in the same boat when it comes to this corona pandemic. But that's not quite true, is it? Some countries and communities have had it much harder than others. We may not be in the same boat, but we are in the same storm. And this storm has caused a major setback for us achieving the Sustainable Development Goals globally.
While we've managed to bring 1 billion people out of poverty since 2000, we're now expecting between 100 and 150 million people to be plunged back into extreme poverty because of COVID-19. Setting us back 5 years. This is unfortunately the first increase in global poverty in decades.
In addition to the obvious healthcare challenges, the pandemic has had a massive impact right across our global goals. From food security to access to education, and from gender equality right through to economic growth.
We won't get in too much trouble.
So we have a lot more work to do as we continue to strive to achieving the Sustainable Development Goals in the next 10 years. And never before has it been more important for the private sector to engage in achieving these goals. Oh.
2020 marks the start of the UN Decade of Action. 2020 gives us the opportunity to reflect and think about the future we want to create. And 2020 forces us to do things differently.
And 2020 helps make the world smaller, where we can use the technologies of today to connect worldwide. And this is what we've done today, allowing you all to join us in this first online Inclusive Business Forum.
So we welcome you and hope you take the opportunity to not only be inspired by some of the great speakers we have lined up today, but connect and form meaningful partnerships with other participants from around the globe. So take some time to come in from the storm as we plot a course for a more inclusive and sustainable future.
Welcome, world.
Hello. Well, I've come in from the cold now. So very happy to come indoors and to join you today. Yes, my name is Mike Debelak, Executive Director of Inclusive Business Sweden. We are super excited to have you here joining us from all around the world, and look forward to a great day together. But before we get into that, let's get down to some serious business, inclusive business. Well, what is inclusive business? Well, inclusive business is around engaging low-income people in the value chain of business as consumers, producers, entrepreneurs, in the value chain of business. It's about developing business models that are not only commercially viable, but can make a significant contribution to the challenges of poverty. And that's where we're focusing today. And it's about finding solutions. And I'm talking about finding solutions for the 1.3 billion people that lack access to electricity, or the 800 million people that lack access to clean water, the 1 billion people who are excluded from basic healthcare, and the hundreds of millions who don't have access to paid work, or the 1 in 8 people on earth that don't have enough to eat to be healthy, or the people lacking access to education, housing, transport, sanitation, communication. So with this, we try to engage people in business models that can help to meet these needs. And on one hand, we find solutions here, but we also like to engage low-income people in the supply chain of business as producers and as entrepreneurs and create more opportunities for generating income. There's tremendous potential here. So that's just a little brief introduction. I think many of you are familiar of Inclusive Business, but I'd just like to briefly introduce ourselves, Inclusive Business Sweden. Our mission is to enable business to meet global development needs. And we do that through three ways. One, through ecosystem management, both in Sweden and globally. And this is really what a big part of today is about. That's about helping people connect, helping different actors and practitioners in the field of inclusive business to connect with each other and to work and to be more successful. And that's really what we're here to do today. We also offer business services directly to businesses, anything from finding opportunities in the inclusive business space to developing business models, to identifying sources of finance, identifying partners, right through to monitoring and evaluation of the impact. And finally, we work with collaborations for development to make sure that we engage with research and innovation programs in this field. And here's some of the smiling faces from our extended team, both here in Sweden and around the world. And we work with a number of different programs. Here's a short sample of some of the programs we work with, from challenge funds to accelerators to organizing events, to doing market studies. We try to engage in a few different areas to push forward this space of inclusive business. And we're very happy to work with a great set of highly innovative, entrepreneurial and engaged clients, members and partners in Sweden and around the world. Now, I'm sure a lot of us are sick of looking at maps with blue and red states. So instead, I decided to share a map with yellow and blue countries. But to date, we have worked very concretely in 14 countries. We do work with countries around the world. We've enabled something like 120 businesses in Sweden and abroad through the work we have done over the last few years. And we're very, very proud of this result, and we hope we can keep working to have a greater impact right around the world. Just a little note about today. Today is made possible by the Inclusive Ventures Program, which is a program funded by the European Region Development Fund and with the West Swedish region. And we're working with our partners at RISE and Johanneberg Science Park on this. And the program itself has actually got a bit of a West Swedish focus. So we're trying to engage with West Swedish SMEs that we work with locally here, but also for them to collaborate with other actors around the world so that they can work towards the sustainable development goals and towards meeting global development needs. And there's two main components of this. One is the Inclusive Business Forum, which is today. And the other thing we are going to be kicking off at the start of 2021 is the Inclusive Ventures Accelerator, which we're officially launching today. And this is a program that will be available just to West Swedish businesses. And so we're launching it. And if there are any West Swedish businesses out there that are interested in joining this, then please go to the website there. And you can hopefully join the accelerator and have some greater impact in the work you do over the coming years. So a few exciting facts about today. We're very excited to see, I think that the participants and the engagement and the interest in this event has exceeded our expectations. And we've really got a great lineup for the day. We have six awesome headline speakers coming from five continents. We have eight calls to action that you can actively collaborate on. We have, as of this morning, 289 registered participants joining in different parts of the day from 257 countries, and already have 296 meetings booked, 696 meetings booked this afternoon, and there's just 6 hours left. So we encourage everyone to make the most of it and really take this opportunity to connect with others from around the world. So thank you and welcome once again. If you want to find out more about us, please go to our website there, www.inclusivebusiness.se. We also have, I should mention, a number of newsletters, Facebook, so LinkedIn, and other social media links that you can follow us on in the future. And if you'd like to reach out to us, there's an email address there. So thank you once again for everyone for joining, and I hope you all have a fantastic day. So I should say we were planning on having another moderator for the event. She has fallen ill. So the bad news is that I will be continuing to take you through the course of the day. But I hope you can put up with that with me for a little bit longer. But let's get into the next steps. I'm super excited to introduce our first speaker who will help with the welcome today, Jan Eliasson, who is also originally from our town of Göteborg. And he has done many things in his over 80 years, is the former Deputy Secretary-General of the United Nations between 2012 and 2016. And particularly at the time of the setup of the Sustainable Development Goals. And was also Sweden's Minister for Foreign Affairs, and has been a mediator in a number of conflicts around the world. So he's really had a great depth of experience, and we're very happy to welcome him here today.
Thank you very much, Mike. Do you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you great.
Good.
Welcome, Jan.
Thank you very much for first offering a tour of the port of Gothenburg, my hometown. It was very, very inspiring. And thank you for this initiative. I think it's absolutely crucial to point to the importance of the word inclusive. In today's world, there is hardly anything you can do and achieve results without accepting to do it together. I would say that the word together is probably the most important word today. And it certainly goes for the Sustainable Development Goals. They can only be achieved if we do it together. Many of those in the different parts of the audience today represent the different actors. And nobody can do everything, but everybody can do something.
Sorry, Jan, yes? Could you just turn on your video for us as well?
There we are.
Thank you.
I try. It says here you can't start your video because the host has stopped it. So it's on your end. Do you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Okay, we'll fix that straight away. They're on it, I'm being told.
Shall I continue or wait until you have...
No, I think please continue.
Okay. Well, I thought I would just make a 10-minute introduction, and then perhaps if you have time to ask a question or two, it's okay. I think it's impossible to start without mentioning the American elections. I think most of our minds are focused on that very important event, because what's happening in the US now will affect not only the American people, but also the world. It has to do with the strength of international cooperation and multilateralism, and it has to do with the creating a less polarized world. So let's hope that the election process will continue, that, as we say, all votes are counted, and that we will not enter a legal and political battle that will immobilize the country. And therefore, I would say that it is important to underline that we need to, in this world, stick together. So let's hope we have the Americans on our side and international cooperation. for the future. I usually talk about the problems we face, but also it's important that we look at the hope factors. And I will just briefly mention the three reasons for me to worry, and then the four reasons to be encouraged, in very, very brief terms. The first, of course, is the climate change issue, related to the SDGs, of course. This is an existential issue, which we all have to embrace. The second issue is the dangerous polarization that we see, not only between countries, but also inside countries. This is a very dangerous trend. We need to underline the importance of dialogue and listening to each other and not demonizing our opponents. We need to bring back the dialogue and conversation in today's world very, very strongly, I would say. The third problematic area is, of course, conflicts. I have dealt with that in my earlier life. And we see dangers of conflicts that are becoming more and more complicated. They become very often proxy wars, where you don't solve it by simply going to the parties. You need to talk to the parties in the region. You need to talk to the UN Security Council. So mediation has become a very difficult business. So these are to me, the three major reasons to worry. But in order to not get too depressed, let me just list quickly the reasons for hope. The main reason for hope may surprise you, but in my analysis, the most important historic factor in bringing the world back to a good course is the role of women. I think historically the women have never played the full role that they, of course, have the right to expect. We will see the women's empowerment, I'm pretty sure, in the next decades or a couple of decades. And it is a force that I think it's important also that men stand behind. And I think it will have a tremendously positive, liberating effect. The second reason for hope is young people, youth. We need to think of what we can do for young people. But it's also very important to think of what we can do with young people. We need to have participation. We need to take an inclusive approach to bring in young people and bring in their dreams and aspirations about employment, about the future, about the environment, about what is right and wrong, and so forth. So here is a tremendous positive force, and I think we have that as an obligation. Facing the world, not least in view of the climate change threat. The third reason for hope is, to me, knowledge, technology, science. You pointed to that in your introduction, Mike. There is a tremendous potential in knowledge. And therefore, I think it's important that the industry, the business sector, and the research community, and the universities realize that they have an enormous important role to contribute to solutions, not least on to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. The fourth reason to feel hope is, of course, international cooperation. It is vital that we realize, and not least that governments realize, that international cooperation and good international solutions are a national interest. We must avoid the false line, or the fake line, I would say, between domestic and international. And we need to bring in the power of the different actors to influence and to realize that the outside world is part of our societies. I usually say about Sweden that Sweden is part of the world, but I also say that the world is also part of Sweden. But here on this point, I would finish by going a little bit more into detail on the issue where I was involved in negotiating when I was Deputy Secretary General of the United Nations, namely the SDGs. The SDGs are universal. In contrast to the Millennium Development Goals, they are, of course, applicable to all countries. I would say the rich countries even have a stronger obligation, and particularly in view of the environmental threats that were caused mostly by the rich part of the world. But I also think it's important that we realize that there is now growing inequalities, not least due to the COVID-19 crisis. But the universal nature of the goals have to be sinking in, and we should also realize, secondly, that they are mutually reinforcing. If we work on one goal, we can also reach into other areas. If you improve the situation on water, for instance, you have immediate effects on health and equality and other goals, education. So the fact that they are interrelated is extremely important to realize. And that they, if I come back to the point about domestic and international, that they also have to be achieved inside our own countries. It's not something that we can point to the UN to do. It is we have to do it in this inclusive manner that that characterizes this conference. My last point is that we are now in the midst of the pandemic crisis, and we have realized, haven't we, how enormously much resources we are putting into the fight against the pandemic. Not only in medical terms, in the terms of hospitals and medication and so forth, but if you look at resources, also in the financial packages, the financial recovery programs that are particularly strong in the rich world, these numbers, these sums are enormous. And I would want us all to think of what kind of world do we want to have post-corona. We should use this period to think about what is the next stage. And to me, the next step to take is to go from the pandemic's fight to the struggle to reach the sustainable development goals. And by that, achieve an action program for the climate agreement in Paris. The Paris Agreement doesn't really have an action plan. The action plan for the Paris Climate Agreement is the Agenda 2030, the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. And if we realize that we have these 17 goals and the many, many targets below them, we actually have a to-do list. We have a toolbox to repair the world. I talked to Johan Rockström, a well-known Swedish climate scientist, and he commended us for having finished the work on the SDGs 2015. And he said, you do not only have a toolbox to repair the world, you also have provided a survival kit for humanity. So if we could move in that direction and recognize that if we are to make it for the decades to come, we have to take this list and achieve it. We have to accept that sustainability is the right thing to do, not only, by the way, the right thing to do morally or ethically. It's also good business. It's a good way of surviving as not only people, but not only as companies, but also as people in the end. So I just commend you for this forum, that you have gathered people from around the world, that you by that have underlined how interconnected we are, that you are stressing so strongly the word inclusive, which is corresponding to my stressing of the word together, and that if we can do this now, we will create a little bit of a new spirit that we need in today's world. There is too much of hopelessness that stops the world, I want to get off, and you can't quite grasp the problems. Just look at the climate change issue. But if we realize that we have an action program which is very concrete, and that has to be done on a broad, among a broad range of actors, then I think we are on the right track. So thank you, Mike, and thank you for all who have organized this or supported this initiative, and to all around the world. I hope that you will have an interesting and exciting day. Thank you very much. I don't hear you.
Jan?
Yes, now I hear you.
Okay, yeah. Great. the joys of technology, yeah, in these sort of events. Thank you very much, Jan. It was a very inspiring presentation. I would ask that if anyone has any questions, we have a bit more time with Jan. You can put them into the Q&A and we'll try to get around to answering them. And you can also vote for questions on the Q&A. But I'd like to kind of start with one while we're waiting for some questions to come through. And that, you know, it's obviously been this year in particular, a number of setbacks. We all know that we have a lot more work to be done to reach the sustainable development goals in just 10 years. But time is ticking, and we, you know, we've made a lot of incremental progress, at least up until COVID hit. We made a lot of incremental progress over the years. But in your mind, what do we need to do to actually sort of change the system, change the setup, move to a much more sort of transformational change? Because my feeling, and many that I've spoken to, is we're not going to get there through incremental improvements. So how do we actually really shift the dial? And what are the main things that we need to do?
Well, I think we have to look at attitudes and new ways of thinking, not only to think of the urgency of the situation. If you look around the world, you have reasons to feel urgency and even hopelessness. So not only a sense of urgency, but also what I said here quickly, rather briefly, that we have to realize that doing this is also in the national interest. These goals that were negotiated in New York for 4.5 years are actually a to-do list at home, and that nobody can escape responsibility. We all have a role to play. I know that the program of these SDGs will not be achieved by UN or by governments. You have to involve all sectors, parliaments, the business sector, the scientific community, the universities, civil society, all of you around this forum. So by that, we should need to bring in a new energy and also get away from this negative sense that polarization has achieved with us. The fact that we don't dialogue enough, that we don't realize that we are, you know, living on one planet and that we are depending on each other, and sort of start the work to work truly in the spirit of the good of the world is the best for us personally in the end. So you're right, Mike. It's about a transformational change, not least now when we see that the pandemics have pushed, have really delayed the work of the goals. There are up to 200 million people who are thrown into extreme poverty. So in all this work, we have to remember the old word and to me, the important word of solidarity. If someone suffers far away, it affects us in the end. And therefore, to have this inclusive approach, the approach of solidarity, and let that go to both the heart and the brain, that's what's required. And that requires leadership, I think, from every corner, and courage to stand up for these basic principles.
Thank you. We have a question coming in from Henk van Duyn from the Two Scale program. How do we incorporate inclusive business in the different sustainable development goals? Do we need to refocus and accelerate our inclusive business approach?
This is something that I'm sure that you work on very hard. I very much would like to suggest a very concrete approach and to solving problems. The way to solve problems, in my view, is to put the problem, the challenge, in the center, not the organization, not the different actors who are involved. It's the problem, the issue, in the center. Let's look at one like water, for instance. Clean water or sanitation that is lacking for over 2 billion people. You put that issue in the center, and then you ask, who can do something about it? And it turns out that you probably have 15, 20 different actors, groups around this. And then you try to have a method of bring them in. And you think and work not vertically in silos, but you work horizontally. You bring in these different actors in solving the problem. And then you achieve, believe it or not, in the end, even a formal or informal division of labor. And I know that we must require the best expertise, the professionals in the silos. They have to be there. But if they only work in the silos, the problems will not be solved.
Yeah.
That goes for a company, it goes for a government, it goes for the United Nations, that we need to break down those walls and bring in the different actors that can contribute. When you do that, you will see a new dynamics appearing, and you will see the richness of different actors' professional skills that will inspire you. So too much in the past, you think you can do it on your own, and you only talk to those who are in the same professions on the same line. Yes, that's interesting, but it doesn't solve the problems of today, which are so complex.
Yeah, great. And I think that's a great connection with what today is about, to bring different actors to the party and to work together collaboratively. I've got another question here from Rafiqul Alam. Which sustainable development goals are now more relevant with the COVID-19 pandemic and in relation to inclusive business? And I've already heard our, and I'm sure you would agree with him, our next speaker, Jack Sim, respond to that to talk about water and sanitation. But are there other areas now that there's been all these shifts in the progress towards a sustainable development goals? Are there some of the sustainable development goals that we should really be focusing on more than others now?
Well, as to the pandemics, of course, the health goal is, of course, crucial. And also the one that both you and I mentioned now, Mike, water, of course. But I would like to still come back to your favorite goal, Mike, 17, which brings back my own point on working together. The partnerships is crucial. You should always ask, when you have a problem in front of you, who else can help me solve this problem?
Mm.
And you should be as generous and open as possible, not sit on information, share information, bring in different actors, and you will see a completely new dynamics coming out. So 17 is important. One that wasn't listed in your introduction was my favorite goal, namely goal 16. Goal 16 is crucial because it connects peace and security on the one hand with development and human rights. There is no peace in the world without development. But there is no development without peace. And there is none of the above, neither peace nor development, without respect of human rights. And that is included in goal 16, with the requirement for peaceful societies, stand up for the rule of law, and also strengthen institutions. Institutions are like the backbone of a body. We need to have strong, healthy, uncorrupt, inclusive, open institutions. So yes, these would be my favorites, but I'm glad that you are looking for what you can do inside your own, if I may say so, goal, quotation marks, but also that you see who else can come in. If you do that, you will find a new energy. That, in combination with another thing which has to do with attitudes, is that we must learn to listen to the vibrations. In other words, we must look at the early warning signs. We as human beings have a tendency to avoid seeing conflicts or problems coming up. We must see the problems early on and act on the vibrations, if I may say so. Not wait for the explosions. If we have a preventive approach in combination with the horizontal working method, then I think we are doing the kind of conceptual change and attitudinal change that are necessary to bring us out of this risk of getting into deep and dangerous polarization and hopelessness. So I'm glad you bring about this broader approach to the meeting today, Mike, and I wish you all the best.
Great, Jan. Thank you very much for your time. We've got more questions coming in, but I think we've run out of time. But thank you very much. I really appreciate you joining us today.
Thank you very much, and good luck.
Great. So the next speaker is Jack Sim, who went from being a commercial businessman to a social entrepreneur to a global change maker. He is the founder of the World Toilet Organization. I once heard him speak, and I think I hope I'm not stealing your thunder, Jack, by saying that you thought that the WTO would be a good name because the real WTO would be too busy to sue you. But we're very happy to have you joining us here today, and welcome.
Hello, everybody. Very happy to listen to Jan Eliasson, who has been so supportive of our creation of the United Nations World Toilet Day, which I will explain later. I'm calling you from Singapore. I'd like to share screen and talk with a PowerPoint. Oh, we cannot share screen while others is sharing.
Oh,
so right. You have to remove this one.
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry.
Thank you very much. So, I got it. Okay, you can see my screen, right? So, basically, COVID has now killed more than 1.2 million people and infected 48 million. There's a global shutdown, a recession. There's a lot of damages that's going on, and mental health is one of the issues that's going to happen because people are in despair when they have financial issues. The half of all the jobs in the world are going to be affected. So what we need to do is to find new customers in the base of the pyramid, because in the good times, the top of the pyramid and the middle of the pyramid was a concentration of companies. But now, because of the pandemic, this top and middle of the pyramid is not buying so much. So you have a big overcapacity in factories and overcapacity in talents. And if we don't find new customer, actually, this is actually detrimental. And of course, we have been neglecting this 60% of the population that we have been not serving, 4 billion customer, which is more than half of the population of the world, and they are worth $12 trillion. So now it's actually a crisis, but a good opportunity for us to have inclusive business to include them in our formal economy. What we need to do is to first understand the needs, and the SDG did detail it that every year there's about $150 billion donated with foreign aid or philanthropies, and yet we continue to have 4 billion people earning less than $8 a day. The COVID is going to push another 100 million into extreme poverty, but you have 1 billion without electricity, 1.3 billion without lighting, 1.6 billion without adequate housing, 2.5 billion without toilets, 4 billion with no internet, and 4.5 billion sewerage not treated, 820 million starvation, 780 million without clean water, and 750 million uneducated. Now you can say these are problems, but you also can say these are opportunity, because in reality, every problem is an opportunity, right? So the solution is that all the solution, all the players were fragmented. So now we have to organize them together like a Swiss watch so that everybody can actually participate without wastages. They are helping one another to succeed. This is an ecosystem, but this is also a trust machine. Today, the way we fund is to make people divided so that we choose the pet project and make NGO fight with one another. In the future, we have to make them collaborate just like the SDG number 17. So the story of Singapore is that when I was young, I grew up in a slum, and then now we have public housing, mass rapid transit, well, third world to first world, not because we receive donation, but because we unlock our people's ability to help themselves. So this is the only way, is through the marketplace. So we created with our Deputy Prime Minister, the BOP World Convention, and then in Mexico, and then back in Singapore again, for all the SDG can be solved together if we create a marketplace that is efficient. And when people earn money, they could buy their healthcare, they can buy their housing, and things will get better. We also form a group called Catalyst 2030 with all the big social entrepreneur group, Ashoka Schwab Foundation, Echoing Green, Skoll Foundation. And now we are mapping all the resources, all the stakeholders, including university, including companies, and make them into alignment, just as I explained before. Because there are 4,000 social entrepreneur inclusive business model that are proven. There's no need to reinvent the wheel. We just have to copy this idea, replicate it, and share it with one another. So the biggest waste in the world is ideas waste. And if these ideas are not wasted, we actually can recycle and reuse and create an efficient ecosystem. So we started with now a partnership with the National University of Singapore, where every faculty in clean tech, in agri tech, in logistics, in fintech, they're all coming together. And I, of course, would welcome cooperation with Sweden and everybody else in the world, because the more inclusive we are, the more efficient we will become. So a big backstory is that I am actually called Mr. Toilet because I created the WTO, World Toilet Organization, in 2001, when people don't want to talk about toilets. And on the 19th of November, we named that day World Toilet Day. And just because of that, the media continuously talked about it. Every year, about 1.5 million people die of diarrhea. And so there's a big demand and there's no supply because it was a neglected subject. So we went to create World Toilet Summit all over the world, getting president and World Health Organization and politician to use toilet as a election issue to win votes. And so the toilets, when it is demanded, becomes very sexy for the politicians. And that started with all the media. We also have a very wonderful supporter, the Crown Prince of the Netherlands, who was the chair of UN Secretary General Advisory Board. And now he's the king, and he's very, very fond of water and sanitation, just like Jan Eliasson. President Clinton also came to support with some fundraising. And so the World Toilet Organization grew throughout the support of a lot of people. Then I went to the UN to lobby for all 193 countries to adopt our founding day, 19th of November, as the official UN World Toilet Day. And Jan Eliasson has been very, very key supporter. And eventually we have all 193 countries unanimously adopting this day. And from that day on, the legitimacy of sanitation came center stage, because in the past they call it a water issue. It doesn't have its own center stage. Now sanitation has World Toilet Day, and World Toilet Day is just a few days later. So remember to celebrate World Toilet Day as it comes. Bill Gates started to reinvent the toilet and invested more than $200 million. And now this off-grid toilet sanitation, safe-managed sanitation standards. Prime Minister Modi won a general election landslide victory when he promised 110 million toilets, and he's completed the construction of this project on October 2nd last year. We also created World Toilet College with Amitabh Bachchan, a very, very famous Bollywood star, and we trained and placed 5,000 toilet cleaners to become professional instead of casual workers, and place them in hotel and hospital and facilities. And in China, there is a president of China, Xi Jinping, who is now the toilet champion for Chinese toilet revolution. So we are now building rural school toilet and working with the Ministry of Education. The Queen last, in 2 years ago, gave us the Commonwealth Points of Light Award that increased our legitimacy. So the whole story of how to solve this is, first we start with powerful storytelling, then the readership in the media increase the interest of the media to continue to write about it. Then politicians realize that if they promise toilet, they get votes and popularity, so they come into the play, and then bureaucrats allocate budget, academia publish their research, celebrity join in to make it popular. Donors now see that this is very, very prominent. They join in, NGOs collect the money and investment, and everybody gets toilet. So can you imagine powerful storytelling can actually create a chain reaction that revolutionized toilet and sanitation agenda over the last 20 years. Now we have to solve poverty. We have a community, we measure what is their needs. We plug and play all the ideas that's already proven for the 4,000 social entrepreneurs in agriculture, energy, ICT, healthcare, education, finance. Then we bring in all the sector players together. So this key map, again, create an ecosystem approach. As you know, silos cannot go very far. If we think about 5G network, computing power is now doubling so fast. We have to think collaboration, ecosystem. And I think this is the way to go, and it's much easier. So we need to think exponential, and we have to think how to do dashboard interfaces, experimentation, engagement, and leverage of all other each other's assets, and create this massive transformative purpose. So if let's say I'm a chili farmer, I'm selling chili at very low price. Why don't I make the chili for them at a very downstream and cut the middleman and sell them on e-commerce, and then create from chili to chili sauce, that's at least 30 times the value of the chili, if not more. So if I can give one time more, 1x to the farmer, he can get out of poverty quite quickly. And if you imagine that coffee that you drink in Starbucks is $5, and inside that $5 of coffee, there's only 3 cents of coffee beans. If it can become 4 cents, the farmers can become much more comfortable. So these are the kind of consideration which is like the SDG number 12, responsible production and consumption. So we partner with university around the world, and if you want to partner, we really, really would like to connect with you. And myself, I've invested 10 million Singapore dollars, which is like $7.5 million, to build this SDG Center in Singapore, brand new building, 65,000 square foot, and it will function a little bit like the de facto World Trade Center for the poor. And we welcome all of you to come together and join us. So we will have co-working space, fab lab, shared services center, train people, but it's also virtual. That means we can work without traveling here with Sweden, with any European countries, Africa, and work together with everyone. So if all of us knew what all of us knew, we would be able to solve the problem together. Thank you very much, and look forward to your questions.
Jack, thank you very, very much. That was great, very inspirational. We are going to take the questions. We have the next speaker and take the questions of, with the two of you as a panel. So Jack will be around, but please, if you have any questions, and particularly if you have any questions for Jack, just say it in the Q&A, and we'll take those questions along with the next speaker. So stay online, Jack. Don't go anywhere. Great. Okay. Thank you. I'd now like to welcome the next speaker. Who is somewhere here? Amin Salih. And Amin is a an inspirational entrepreneur and the founder of Zarkol, based out of Ghana, working with two of my favorite things, energy and coconuts. But I'll let you and explain more about what you do and what you've built in Ghana and West Africa.
Right. Thank you for the opportunity, and good morning to everyone. I guess I'll just share my screen.
Yes.
There you go.
Excellent.
All right. I hope you can all see the screen.
Yeah, if you can make it a little bit, can you able to do a screen view, full screen view? There we go. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So, like I said, good morning, and then thanks for having me. My name is Amin Sule, and I am the founder of Zarkol. Usually when we talk about energy or access to energy, all the focus and attention is shifted to solar energy, oil and gas industry. We're talking about all the other forms of energy, but we usually overlook or ignore the main primary energy, especially in this part of the world where people need it on a daily basis, mostly for cooking. And quite unfortunate for a number of people around the world, they don't have access to oil and gas or electricity to make their cooking as efficient and as cool as we all may seem to expect. So unfortunately, a lot of these people are forced to cut down trees, look for other ways of accessing energy to cook foods on a daily basis. So basically my company is addressing all of these challenges, and the company is called Zarkol. So literally Zarkol means hot coal. It's a merger of two words, a Hausa word that means hot, which is widely spoken across the West African sub-region, and then coal, which we all know. So basically we are addressing these two problems, access to energy, and then how clean is this energy that people are accessing? Just like I mentioned earlier, people ideally would go cut trees, use cow dance, and several other things to cook. And all of these are generating so much smoke, degrading the environment, and causing a number of problems for us. As you can see on the other picture, there is also the problem of deforestation, because for us to able to access energy for cooking, we'll definitely have to cut down trees, deplete our forests, probably just destroy all the wildlife that comes with it, just because we have to cook and feed ourselves. The other picture you see, which is also another problem we are solving, is the issue of pollution, because we live in a part of the world where there's no centralized or a well-organized waste management system. So this presents a bigger problem. And in the picture, you can see that there's an image of a lot of coconut and plastic piled up at one of the beaches in Ghana. And then the other thing is the access to energy. How accessible is this energy to the people who need it most, and especially when they actually need it? And this is a graph I got from the World Health Organization, and we can all see it's quite an old graph, but still very relevant, because all that is in here is still prevails today. And as you can see, pollution in general actually kills more people than all known diseases together, whether it's indoor air pollution, outdoor air pollution, contaminated water, sanitation in general, leads to a lot more deaths than all known diseases, much higher than cancer, HIV, tuberculosis, etc. Good. So this is basically what Zarco does. I live in a country where we have hundreds and thousands of coconut vendors all over the country, all over the street selling their coconuts. But then what do they do with their waste when they are done selling? And this is where Zarco comes in. So basically my business started with out of curiosity. So I started asking myself what these guys were doing with their daily waste and how can we make something good out of this? So it all started with just collecting a handful of coconuts, experimenting them in this small tomato can. We moved to a bucket, moved to barrels. We got chimneys so we don't pollute the environment. All of these just to experiment the viability of an idea, which is converting coconut waste into clean and affordable charcoal that can be accessible to everyone anywhere in the country. As you can see here, when we started, we basically lacked a lot of technology. So at the time we were using ice cube molds. We press our charcoal in there, and when it's dry, it takes the shape of these ice cube molds. My company started very small with a lot of manual and labor intensive production processes. It went through a number of chains, a number of channels. I dedicated this space, which you see is the front of my house. And these are coconut vendors on a daily basis coming in to dump their waste. So you can imagine I am collecting this much in a space of 2 days. Now, in the absence of this space I have provided for these guys in front of my house, where do we think they are going to dispose them? They are obviously going to end up at the beaches and then end up destroying the whole ecosystem we have in the ocean. Another picture that shows you how much volume coconut vendors are, how much volume of waste coconut vendors are generating on a daily basis. And here you can see the inside of my house that shows you exactly the real situation. So we are saving the problem of waste management. We are solving the problem of pollution, and all of this will be used in the end to produce clean, affordable charcoal for the people that need them most. Good. So just like I mentioned, this is a picture of one of the beaches in my country. So if Amin does not collect all of these coconuts, basically this is where it ends up. And we all can see it's not a cool sight. More pictures just to show you. Good. So we package our product in paper bags, and then you can see this is a picture I actually call Choices. Our product, which is Zarco, sells at an extremely affordable price. So even though it can't package in a paper bag, you can see just opposed to what the woman is already selling on the table, it comes in the cans and the plastic. So when a customer buys, she now pours it into a plastic bag. But then with Zarco, you just pick the paper bag and then you're done. So it also saves the woman the cost of buying the plastic bag just to package. We started just like you saw in the images, very, very small, started stocking in a number of stores, having a number of retailers all across the country. And as I speak, you can see the progress in how our business has grown from basically a house or a backyard-based factory to probably having one of the biggest charcoal production plants on the continent of Africa. This new facility we have has an installed capacity of about 3 tons per hour, and we are selling quite a number of volumes to the local market and also to the export market. This is the inside of the new factory that we just commissioned about 2 months ago. Our team has grown from just myself to almost a team of 15 people in the factory, indirectly employing hundreds of people collecting the coconut waste for us from the streets, and then furthermore, hundreds of people that are already selling the products also in the country. This is a collection of all the products that we have. And this is a picture that I say that you deserve that smile, because when you use our product, it comes and produces much less smoke compared to the badly processed wood charcoal or any other kind of charcoal. Energy is very important. We all need it to survive. But then to some people, energy is not just about having a light on. Energy is about the ability to feed yourself and a family, and the way you do it actually matters. Thank you so much, and I'll be on standby for your questions.
And thank you very so much. With that presentation, you also put a smile on my face. So thank you very much. It was very good, and welcome back, Jack. But it was really great to hear this story. I actually came across a while ago, I think it was just a video on Facebook about your story about building this from nothing, and it was very inspirational.
Thank you.
So both Jack and Armin, we're going to take some questions from the Q&A. So if anyone would like to post questions, please do so there. But I would like to start one, and in that what I see you both have in common is that you have, you're both social entrepreneurs. You've both built something from the ground up. Jack, at the global level, I can't imagine the conversations you might have had speaking to the UN about toilets. And Armin, you built something up from ice cube trays to a major processing facility and distribution across Ghana. There are a lot of people out there, and there are a lot of people online that are trying to do these things, that are trying as individuals to make this change, to make these transformations, to build these businesses. What I'd like to ask you both to start is, what are the secrets of your success? What have you done differently that has really worked for you?
You want to go? Oh, okay, I go. So I think that alone is we cannot do much. Once we have an idea, whether it's our own idea or somebody else's idea, we should immediately copy it, replicate it. Now, most people will say, why should I give away my idea to you? I worked so hard to create it, and I might lose my funder if I give the idea to you, and then now I'm going to close down because you took over my idea. I think we have to remember what we are alive for. It's not about us. It's about solving the problem. If we can give our ideas to everybody, we will still have the idea. We can work on places where other people are not working on. So I would say to the funders, stop dividing the people. Stop betting on your favorite pet project. Get people together and encourage whoever you're funding to share the idea with everybody free of charge. Because the funder is also trying to score points to say, I funded it. No, if you funded it, give the idea to everyone. And when this is replicated, just like Zako, you can go everywhere. Immediately I'm thinking, hey, maybe I should go and copy Armin, right? Because I'm not going to do it. I'm going to take his idea and give to another 200 people. And I think if we knew what we all knew, we will solve the problem together. We have to love and trust and share. And it's not about us, it's about humanity.
Thank you, Jack. I think you're right. An idea is probably the one thing that you can share and still keep it for yourself. You can give it away and keep it for yourself too. Armin?
Yeah, so just like Jack said, it's all about empathy. It's all about seeing that there is a solution to almost every problem out there. And you are also part of that solution. It's not always good to sit out and sit back looking or expecting others to solve your problems for you. So what really keeps us going as entrepreneurs or businesses is to really go beyond the mere fact that we can just look at a problem and complain about it, but also find a solution and be part of that solution. Having the empathy, just like you said, it's not that all about you. It's all about humanity, because you're part of humanity. What affects humanity affects you. So you better be a part of that solution that makes humanity the best we are looking for.
Great. Let's all keep that in mind today and every day for that matter. Okay, we have another question to Jack here. It's true that a large number of people in developing countries, including Tanzania, which I think Infinix is based in, are working in rural communities, and the situation is quite difficult there. I'm paraphrasing a little bit of the question here. But water, sanitation and hygiene, having access to toilet and soap is very challenging. So how do you involve, for example, I think they're asking about how do you involve, for example, soap in this question of the World Toilet Organization and what you do. Obviously you have, there's something we all focus on, the access to toilets, but I guess especially now in the time of COVID, the access to soap once you use the toilets is probably just as important, and that's not something that's always taken into account in the first place. How do you address this in this challenging time?
Oh, we can copy somebody who knows how to make soap or detergent, and then we can create small little factory everywhere. We can also go to hotels where every time they use the soap one time and then they throw it away. We can ask all the hotel to subscribe to donating this soap to other people to reuse. And so I think there are a lot of models, like there's one company called the Soap Factory. So you can just copy their idea and you can go and collect from the hotels in the cities nearby. So I think that the other part is to promote hand washing, because once you wash your hands, you can reduce so many diseases. You can reduce up to 50% of all the hospital bed in the developing country if you have hand washing and proper sanitation and don't pollute the river. So I think that all the answers, if you like, you email to me and I can ask you who to copy. And that's the whole idea of the SDG Center. The whole idea is there are 4,000 people who already have the business model. Now I include the Zarco as one more, and then there's 4,001 idea now. We could copy.
I think that's great. I think there's, you know, sometimes in the inclusive business space, we try to get focused on innovation. Let's innovate, let's find new business models and new products and solutions. But I think, your point about replication is important, because there are a lot of great solutions out there and they just need to spread. I mean, we've got a question for you here. It's I'm combining two questions in one, but there was one question around, have you considered using other materials other than coconut shells for producing charcoal? And then there's another question around the level of pollution to charcoal compared to coal or wood.
Okay, I'll start with the second one. So charcoal is processed such that the level of pollution is way, 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 way much lower compared to normal traditional coal or even wood-based coal. We have done a number of tests from the scientific community, from the standards industry, just to make sure we fall within accepted regulations. And we always exceed most of these regulations out there. To the second question that asks if we can look at other waste materials. It is true we can use other waste materials. We've tried bamboo, we've tried sugarcane, we've even tried with grass. But then in our jurisdiction, which is in my country, Ghana, we have an abundance of coconuts, which ideally are going waste. So we kind of stuck with coconuts because it is the most and readily accessible raw material for us here. But wherever you are in the world, any organic raw material that, or any waste material that is available to you, we can always have a conversation to see how we can help you use what's available to you to produce.
Great, thank you. So we have a question locally from Helene Albori, and it's to you, Jack. I think it's regarding the comments you made before around trying to copy ideas versus picking winners. Are you by this also saying that the logic of incubation should change somehow? Is the current focus on picking winners a barrier to innovation?
I think that first of all, you stand on the shoulders of giants. So the incubation always have a learning curve, and all these startups, they go bankrupt after during the learning curve. If they already knew how to make money because they copied some matured proven ideas, then they wouldn't enter into the valley of death so fast. So most startups go bankrupt anyway. And the reason they go bankrupt is that they're still learning how to do their business by the time the money is finished. So what you do? You take an idea that is already happening. Let's say you take Zako and you say, okay, this is what they do. Then you ask, why is Zako not everywhere? Oh, Zako is not everywhere because there's some constraint. Okay, then you start hacking on top of that to say, maybe I can do this with other agricultural residual. Maybe I can do it with the stocks of rice. Maybe I can use rice husk. Maybe I can do... Suddenly, you think of other ideas. And then you say, hey, there's somebody already using rice husk. Why is he not scaling? Then you take two or three ideas, put them together. That's your innovation. You see, we have a trolley bag. Every time I go to the airport, I don't have to carry. I just drag it. The trolley bag is a bag that copy the wheels and put the wheels on the bag. Both ideas are copied, but the third idea called the trolley bag is invented. So don't invent things, combine things.
Yeah. Great. We have another question coming through. Just a little reminder for those that want to point a question, please post it on the Q&A function and not on the chat function. But I've come across one in the chat from Armin Bauer. Do you also, and this is for Armin, do you also work with companies that produce charcoal stoves? Often the stove makes the smoke and reduces the fuel cost.
Yeah, that is a very proven model, I should say. It has been found that it is the stove that sometimes actually produces the smoke, and then how the customers or the users light their product. We are trying to have this kind of partnership with a number of stove producers, but unfortunately for us, we don't really have like a large scale stove manufacturing company in Ghana at the moment. So we're just, by this throwing out our request to anyone who produces smoke and want to partner Zako, I think it would be a wonderful collaboration to have anyone using a very clean cook stove now using a clean fuel, because I've always held the view of us now encouraging people to use clean cook stoves. But then what do you do with a clean cook stove whilst you're still reliant on a dirty fuel? So it kind of disproportionately balances the equation. But it would be really good if we have both a clean burning fuel and a much cleaner cooking stove, which makes the equation very well balanced. So we are by this also looking forward to anyone that's interested in that space and want to partner with us.
Great, thank you, Armin. I'm actually going to take one question that Jack has already answered in the Q&A function, but I think it's worth to share with the broader participants. And it's the question around when building toilets, are you also reassuring circular systems, making sure nutrients are being reused, and preferably also providing knowledge on sustainable urban gardening, farming, etc.?
Yes, I think that the first of all, sanitation has to be safe. That means you cannot do open defecation and then have the flies spread it around. So sanitation has to be safely managed so that it doesn't spread disease either through flies, through fluid, through fingers, through food, and through feet, right? So that part is the very critical part, containment. So some treatment is needed. But if you were to say recycle and reuse of it into fertilizer, then that is a bigger question of viability, sustainability. For example, if you have a very little shit and you want to process it into a fertilizer, it's not viable, right? For me, I always urinate in my garden on the trees so that my garden trees grow very tall. That is one form of recycling immediately. But I can't recycle my shit on the tree because I flush it in the toilet. So the pragmatic issue, you have to think about it, yeah. Right? So when you can do it. For example, if you have a very highly dense population, then you can collect a lot. But if you have people living far away from one another, you can't do very much, but make sure it is safe.
Yeah, you really know your shit, Jack. thanks for that. There's another question for you, Jack, here is the public toilets have many challenges in terms of its operations. Mm. About the public toilet management, you might install a toilet, but we know that if they're not maintained properly, they can become very dirty, they can break. How do you encourage that is handled, and how important is that in the work you do?
Yes. So right now we are working together with Nippon Foundation from Japan to export their Japanese toilet culture. Because you cannot have just toilet, you have to have a toilet culture. In India, they built a lot of toilet. Then now we are trying to teach people to use toilet. So I think that public toilet needs three things, A, B, C. The architecture, the design has to be easy to maintain, robust, and easy to be dry. So there is sunlight, there is ventilation, and all that. Very important. Cannot be very humid. Secondly, there need to be a cleaner, professionally trained to clean it, and paid to do it, so that this motivated and trained cleaner can provide this. Then when the toilet respect the user will respect the toilet. So the B, the behavior. So architecture, behavior, and cleaning is very, very critical. And if you continue to have these three, the cycle will be continuously good. But if one is missing, then the cycle is broken, and then you start to see dirty toilet. So demand for cleanliness. And once you demand, there will be supply.
Thank you. So Jack, you were talking about constraints around things being replicated. And, you know, thinking about, for example, Zarkol and it being a great solution. What do you think holds us back from these type of solutions being available everywhere? Surely if Zarkol is a cleaner, affordable solution, and there's plenty of waste material, as one example, why haven't we seen this everywhere? It's not new to produce, for example, energy from waste. It's not new to have toilets that are well maintained. But what's holding us back from, why haven't we seen all of these solutions everywhere already? What's holding us back?
I think culturally, we are very individualistic. We are either greedy to make the profit for ourselves or greedy to get the donors' money for ourselves. And we are always on survival mode. Secondly, we are very vain people. We think that we are the smartest. You don't save the world. I save the world. The world must wait for me to go and slowly save them. You don't have the capacity. So we have to come to a new culture where we are humble. We are realizing that we are only able to do something. And that if everybody is helping, then we are able to do great things. So we cannot put our personal ego and aspiration at paramount level. We are servant to the mission. We have to put mission at paramount level. And this is counterintuitive. Now, if you add that with the donor who says, no, I want you guys to fight. And the one who's proved to me that you are the greatest, I'm going to give you a lot of money. But for you, no money. And once you start to do that, you start to destroy collaboration. And the NGOs and the social entrepreneur start to become very suspicious of one another. So this culture we have to break. Because the most important thing for me is to know that I'm going to die. And there is no need to be famous. There's no need to be rich as long as I have food and a place to sleep and a loving family. The rest is not important. The most important thing is I'm useful. Now, if you are going to die, sure to die, because everybody die around 80, 85, sometimes 70, they die. So what are you here for? You are here to be useful to society. And so if you remember that, you don't have to care about yourself so much. You care about the solution, the mission, and everybody is your friend.
That's great. Ahmed, would you like to answer that question as well?
I mean, he went straight to the point. A lot of us want to live hundreds of years. I mean, people are looking for medications that can lengthen our lives on earth. Immortality to me is leaving a positive impact that gets your name mentioned 100 years after you are dead and gone. So it's all about doing the right thing, having the empathy and making sure whatever you do isn't just for you alone, but for generations to come, because there are so many things we enjoy today in our lives that were done by people we've never met.
Yeah.
But their lives are having an impact on us. So basically, that's how it should be.
Great. Thank you very much. Well, I think with those words, I don't think we can really top those last couple of comments. I think there's something in that to reflect on. So I think we're going to wrap up the panel now and just do a little bit of preparation before the break. But Jack and Armin, thank you both very much for joining us today and for letting us in on your stories of success, but also on the great and deep insights you have into how we should work together, how we should be open and collaborate, how we should try to do something good in this world before we all die. So thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you. Great. So we will. We're about to have a break for the day. But before we do that, don't go anywhere. Just going to do a little bit of preparation. What we have after the break is what we call our calls to action. So I think with those last words about doing something together and sharing, this is really what this is about. It was actually a great introduction to this part of the agenda, because it is the UN Decade of Action, and we really want to make sure that we are action focused today. You know, I mean, we're here to be inspired, but we're also here to move things forward. And so we've had a number of organizations that you could see here that are hosting calls to action after the break. And these will be 1.5 hour sessions where you will get a short introduction to what these organizations are doing, but you'll also have the chance to collaborate on this, to work together, to have input, to discuss these things and so forth, and to also find opportunities for collaboration. So it's going to be really hands-on and concrete. So there's 8 calls to action here. I'll just go very briefly. The first one's on nutrition, healthy diets. The second one is on sanitation, water and sanitation, or actually more on the sanitation. What if we could be paid to poo? Third one is from the Kenya Nordic Green Hub, tackling organic waste in Kenya. Then we have one on forcibly displaced people. How can we support refugee startups? One on your capital, your impacts on the investment space, increasing financing capacity for small cooperatives, developing a thriving and inclusive green economy in Ghana. And then there's finally one that I don't think you can see there, which is on north-south partnerships. Now, this last one I would say is, I'll actually be hosting that one, but it is very broad. It's going to be very broad. The other ones are going to be much more concrete, but we wanted to have something for everyone. So I would encourage you, if you have any connections with the first 7 to join those seven calls to action, and to join those seven calls to action and to work with the organizations there. And then if none of them fit you, you can join the eighth one, and we'll do some things then.
Okay, welcome back, everyone. Hope you've all had a good lunch, breakfast, or dinner, depending where you are in the world, and that you also had some good meetings and a great call to action workshop. We've got some three fantastic speakers lined up for you next. And as the participants come back in the room, we're just going to take a moment before we start with them to just have a little bit of a short wrap up, if anyone would like to share from the call to actions. So what I would ask is, I can allow anyone who wants to say a few words about the discussion they had in the call to action workshops before the break. And all you have to do is, there should be a function there where you can raise your hand, if you can find that on your screen, if you would like to say something about what you discussed and achieved in your call to action workshops. So we have the list of the call to action workshops there. Would anybody like to volunteer?
Hi, Mike, this is Sanas. I have not been able to find the raise your hand, but I can start if you like.
Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you, Sanas.
Thank you very much. My name is Sanas Sedig. I'm from ACT Church of Sweden, and I'm the program manager for Uganda. And in our call to action, we were discussing the innovative finance for improved livelihoods in Kenya and Uganda. It's a five-year project. And the key discussions were on the aspect of capacity building that the project has, and how it's key for sustainability and really building the organizations. The project focuses on providing loans to smaller farmer-based organizations. What is important that we felt is that nowadays there is a lot focus on the lending, however, not on the capacity building, and that does not enable the organizations to maintain their position and be able to access future funding, as their certain capacities within the organizations have not been built up, and so it doesn't enable them to move on. So that was something that we discussed, and also bringing in several different players from different sectors and different niches to a similar project, which brings a lot of added value, and how IT can help effectivize capacity building. So thank you very much.
Great. Thanks, Dennis, and thanks for joining us today and hosting that session.
Right,
please go. Please go ahead.
Should I?
Yes.
Sorry, don't mean to interrupt anyone.
No, please go ahead.
I'm starting my video. Hi, everyone. My name is Svetlana, and I'm here with MAD Group. My colleague Fiona Hazel, she couldn't join at this point of time, but I'm representing our organization. And we had the call to action number 3. Which was about the paid to poop model. And this topic has been since the very morning with our key speakers. And so we felt like we were in line with the conversations that has been happening before earlier this day. In maximum, we had 18 participants during the call to action. And we were mostly discussing, we presented the model, and then we divided our participants into groups to hear back from them about two things. First, we wanted to hear what are the overlooked challenges in our model that we might have omitted, social, economic, technical, because people from different backgrounds has joined our session, so we wanted to hear from them. But the next step was to discuss what are the possibilities to do something about that, how to overcome these challenges, and what in particular their organization or them personally can do about that, which was kind of like inviting people to step in and take more of a proactive position. At the end, we agreed on further steps. How do we continue our communication? How do we stay in touch? Which was a very important thing. People were quite engaged and interested to continue the conversation. So we felt like everything went very smooth. And just a tremendous thanks for Annika and Daniela for your great job in explaining all the technical details to us. But at the end, it ran very smoothly. So thanks so much one more time for giving us this opportunity to run the call to action. I think it's a beautiful format, and we should definitely have more this interactive and engaging formats during events like we are having today. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Svetlana. Thank you.
Thanks.
I think I saw Charles come up on screen before. Do you want to share from your group?
Hey, hi, everyone. So I'm representing Biane from the call to action number 5, which we're tackling organic waste in Kenya. So we had quite a diverse audience and diverse presenters. And we had presentations from the ministry, and some of the key takeaways were the ministry has a lot of legislation and governance in place. So how do we actualize all this legislation, and good governance in place, merging it with the good work that innovators like Edwin from Eco Holdings are doing. So we were able to have very positive discussions, and Edwin was very good at answering a lot of the discussions and some of the challenges and barriers to entry. And Dr. Ayub from the ministry was really good at giving us what is the governance structures, what are the new laws, what's the new legislation coming in, and how can we work in synergy and work together going forward. So with the next few weeks, he informed us that there'll be a lot of public participation, PR going into behavior change. Mm-hmm. So we had some really good discussions on how we can feed into each other as implementers in terms of the policy level and in terms of the innovation level. Mm-hmm. So our call to action, what we agreed on, is to convene a multi-stakeholder meeting with some of the tech providers and the ministry, and there's a task force in place. So how do we, going forward in the next couple of weeks, how do we take that forward and bring everyone on board to now actually start realizing the call to action towards 2030. Yeah, that was it.
Thank you very much, Charles. Maybe we have time for one more, whoever's can share their video fastest. If anyone else, Håkan.
Yeah, thank you. So I took the chance to do a crowdsourcing event of this. We talk about forcibly displaced people, the 79 million people that are forcibly displaced due to war or climate or anything else, and their situation being either victimized due to the situations or due to how our systems are processing them, and or they are empowered. And the empowerment that we talked about was to help them actually create jobs for themselves. And I presented the way that we do that through startup academies and incubation for refugees and for trafficking victims. And then I shared the dilemma that we have. Is it, we have people that have capacity. Everybody sees the need for it, and there's plenty of money for this type of results. But for small organizations like ourselves, to connect the dots is really difficult. Mm. To find the funding, because we don't have time, we don't have energy, we don't have the connection. So we made this to become a crowdsourcing event, where we say, with the theory of 6 degrees of separation, where you have just a connection to somebody that has a connection to somebody, with 6 steps, everybody can reach the president of the United States, whoever that is. and so we challenged one another to say, with just 3 degrees of separation, who do you know that knows somebody that is a decision maker that can help fund a thing like what we are doing in 9 countries today, which actually works, but we don't have the funding to scale. So that's what we did.
Great, good to hear. Thank you very much. It sounded like there was a lot of good, unfortunately we don't have time for all of them. We don't want to keep our speakers waiting. But it sounds like there were some really productive conversations and collaborations going on. So great. But let's move on. I'm very happy to welcome the first afternoon speaker, Pamela Koch-Hamilton. She is the executive director of the International Trade Center and has worked extensively in the private sector across Africa, Caribbean, and Pacific countries, as well as with universities and academia to build trade-related institutional strength within member states. This is actually the second time we've had the executive director of the International Trade Center speak at one of our forums. We had Arantxa a few years back, and she was fantastic. And we welcome you, Pamela, to let us know a little bit about more about what you're working with at ITC. So welcome.
Thank you very much, Mike. I'm very happy to be here. Let me just start off by thanking you all for the invitation, and good afternoon or good morning, depending on where you are. It's my pleasure to be here with you today to take part in this year's virtual edition of the Inclusive Business Forum. As one of the most innovative countries in the world, Sweden and its private sector have continuously sought new approaches to push greater sustainability in Sweden and across the globe. I'm delighted to be here among such inspiring speakers, including former Deputy Secretary-General of the UN, Jan Eliasson, and Sanda Ojiambo, the newly appointed Executive Director of the UN Global Compact. Both Sanda and I are in pretty much the first month of our mandates, and it's a testament to the importance of this topic that we're both here. The forum's topic, the decade of action, could not be more accurate as we try to navigate our way out of the COVID-19 pandemic. It has, as you know, exacerbated existing challenges in the global economy, especially for micro, small, and medium-sized enterprises. To overcome these challenges, comprehensive actions are required to adapt, to build back better and bolder. In the next few minutes, I'd like to focus on how we at the International Trade Center are supporting MSMEs to adapt to the new normal and to increase their resilience as we move through this period of recovery. As MSMEs are such an important contributor to the socioeconomic glue of local societies, we're working along the entire value chain to catalyze impact and create synergies and systemic change. We're intervening across 3 interrelated domains of action and work, not only with MSMEs to foster competitiveness and internationalization, but extend our assistance to the entire ecosystem in which they are embedded. This means that we assist at the local and regional level with business support organizations and institutions to improve their connectedness and services by providing training and knowledge sharing activities to increase their expertise. Moreover, we provide advice to national and international policymakers to create an enabling policy framework for MSMEs to thrive. The pandemic has strongly affected business communities worldwide. I think that's well known. In the past few months, we have experienced unparalleled government decisions to enact border closures, which have led to an unprecedented and complete shutdown of many economies and has had a strong impact on the demand and supply for essential products. A look at the decimation of the tourist industry in the Caribbean, where I'm from, or the cut flower industry in East Africa is a clear testament to this reality. To gauge the impact that COVID-19 has on businesses, ITC conducted a survey of more than 6,000 MSMEs in 109 countries. The survey findings show that nearly 70% of small enterprises are strongly affected by the crisis. Due to movement restrictions, transporting goods along the value chain has become increasingly challenging, and related transportation costs have increased. For example, in Côte d'Ivoire, cooperatives and producers in the shea sector have difficulties exporting due to a fall in demand. The cashew sector in West Africa has suffered after border closures prevented major buyers from flying in to source raw cashews. and farmers in the Gambia have nowhere to sell their harvest due to the suspension of public gatherings, which includes daily and weekly markets. With operations and profits slowing down and funds reallocated to emergency budget lines, producers will be hard-pressed to receive payment on time. A decrease in cash flow has already forced many businesses to downsize or lay off workers. Many MSMEs are at risk of closing permanently this year. Therefore, almost 500 million people are at risk of losing their jobs in the near future. The enumerated impacts of COVID-19 were disproportionately felt by the most vulnerable individuals and communities, and those hit hardest have been poor communities, youth, and women. Overall, the results of the pandemic could push 100 million people back below the poverty line and could also strongly impede our ability to reach the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals by 2030. The grave impact of the pandemic I've just described show the global economy's vulnerability to external shocks. As severe as the consequences are, the global shakeup, however, also provides an opportunity. Climate change and environmental degradation will continue to impact our society, economy, and environment in the mid to long term. And thus, it is central in the post-COVID-19 era to make transformation and decarbonization part of the economic recovery. Green and regenerative recovery plans in response to the pandemic should contribute to promoting business models and practices that make enterprises more resilient to external climate-induced shocks and foster biodiversity conservation and its sustainable use. Addressing the needs for a green transition brings various opportunities to MSMEs. However, they often need support to implement the respective measures. At ITC, we believe that businesses need to be the protagonist in crisis response measures and recovery efforts to build back better in a more sustainable manner. On the global level, joint action by different stakeholders, such as public entities, academia, private sector, and civil society, are ever more important to building back better and for trade to become an enabler of green goods, services, and technology. Making production and trade more sustainable and inclusive can be a powerful means to facilitate the transition to more resilient economies. Embracing these considerations also contributes to better risk management, especially at the bottom end of the value chains, where producers were hit hardest by the crisis. By reducing the economy's impact on the environment, by making businesses and value chains more robust, and improving access to decent and secure jobs, we will be able to mitigate the worst effects of the pandemic and to reduce the likelihood and severity of future crises. These considerations spark the debate on how to make business models more resilient and how to embed sustainability considerations into the recovery. To convince businesses to adopt sustainable practices, they need to see the immediate benefits resulting from this transition, and the business case needs to be clear. By implementing the respective practices, MSMEs seize four major opportunities. Firstly, becoming climate resilient makes companies more competitive. They can reduce production and operation costs and benefit from new business opportunities, such as new product lines. At the same time, adhering to sustainability standards improves their reputation and image with buyers and consumers alike. Thirdly, they're able to anticipate national and international environmental policies, such as limits on water and energy consumption, as well as waste production. Finally, creating a business case for climate adaptation measures may unlock new types of financing opportunities, which are crucial for successful implementation of adaptation measures. MSMEs from developing countries especially will need support to reap all these benefits. Therefore, we support enterprises to get ready for the new normal by developing inclusive and environmentally responsible business models and supply chains. Firstly, we support enterprises and market partners to implement climate resilient and resource efficient practices. MSMEs thereby increase their international competitiveness and reduce adverse business risks, including those induced by climate change, overconsumption of natural resources, and unethical labor practices. Secondly, our technical assistance addresses internationally recognized social and labor standards to ensure that the poor and vulnerable are not left behind or bear the brunt of low wages and poor working conditions. These two pillars enhance at the same time the third one, which concerns the long-term financial viability of the company. To implement the three pillars, we focus our support to beneficiaries active in the agribusiness, textile, and garments, as well as the tourism sectors. Moreover, we assist the young emergent entrepreneurs who are innovating on green products and services, as well as women, local communities, and indigenous people. To facilitate access to finance, we support MSMEs to develop bankable sustainability projects and to become ready for green investments. By working these beneficiary groups in different projects in Africa, Southeast Asia, and Latin America, we ensure that our sustainability and inclusiveness initiatives contribute to poverty alleviation and improve livelihoods. How do these interventions appear in practice? And how do we ensure that MSMEs are indeed becoming core players in sustainable growth? Let me use three examples from our projects to show you how we support businesses to become more sustainable and competitive. ITC's approach to agribusiness development is to enhance crop and product diversification to reduce developing countries' reliance on a single source of income. It is well established that reliance on a single buyer or income channel, combined with exposure to price volatility or other risks such as pests and diseases, leaves agripreneurs and farmers without alternative means of income during crises. By supporting a diversified cropping system, we contribute to mitigating the impact that crises like COVID-19 have on traditional exports. In Ghana, ITC supports cocoa and associated crops to implement climate smart practices and enhance product diversification. This has generated benefits in terms of household nutrition, but also for biodiversity. The number of cocoa farmers adopting climate smart practices has quadrupled between 2018 and 2020, and the sales of cocoa beans and associated crops have increased. As we pay particular attention to the economic empowerment of women, we exceeded our target by 400% in the number of women who were able to engage in business transactions. The same methodology for sustainable and resilient agribusiness development is applied to coconuts and associated crops in selected countries in the Caribbean. In this project, we aim to enable the participating Caribbean states to capitalize on the rapidly growing global demand for coconuts. For instance, the global trade in coconut water alone is projected to grow by more than 25% in the next 5 years. At the same time, we aim to strengthen environmental sustainability through capacity building activities in agricultural practices and climate smart demonstration plots, for instance, through climate smart irrigation systems. Here too, we aim to foster product and market diversification through the identification of product and market opportunities in the UK, the US, and the European market. To promote resource efficiency and circular production principles, we also promote climate smart waste management practices. Finally, we also focus on fostering sustainability in and through the tech sector. We support not only the development of digital entrepreneurs and tech startups through trainings and connections, but also pay special attention to ensure that their business cases focus on green tech. For instance, by supporting the design of solutions to improve the way we use natural resources. In Uganda, we coach MSMEs, which are optimizing solar systems by extending their lifespan through data analytics. By linking with our agribusiness practice, we contribute to the improvement of farming practices, for instance, through the application of smart sensors used for irrigation. By supporting MSMEs to adapt resource-efficient and circular production methods in these different sectors, we increase their climate resilience and decrease their production costs through a better management of energy, water, and waste. This improves the chances of business continuity and increases their resilience with regard to external shocks. We believe that our initiatives to embed sustainability considerations into the recovery can be further scaled up with supported national and international policies, which integrate sustainability and environmental considerations. Additionally, any stakeholder along an international value chain, from the local producer in a developing country to the consumer to the international buyer, anyone can play his or her role to transform our economy to a more sustainable one by demanding sustainable products, by adhering to sustainability standards, and by implementing sustainable business practices. I hope this has been useful, and I look forward to the conversation hereafter. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you very much, Pamela. It was great to hear about all the fantastic work you're doing at the ITC, and despite all the significant challenges that we're facing, that there is progress being made and that can be made. So that gives us some hope. We're going to have all three speakers in a panel after they present. So we're going to move on. But if I could, just a reminder that everybody can post your questions in the Q&A. Please mention who you'd like the question directed to of the three speakers, if it's directed to one person, or we can open it up to all three. But use the Q&A function if you have any questions. So next, I would like to introduce Jacqueline Novogratz, who in 1986 left her job on Wall Street and co-founded Rwanda's first microfinance institution, which inspired her to write the bestseller, The Blue Sweater, Bridging the Gap Between the Rich and the Poor, and also to create Acumen. And Acumen to date has invested over $128 million to support more than 128 social enterprises around the globe. So some fantastic results there, and we hope to hear more from you, Jacqueline. So thank you for joining us today.
Thanks, Mike. And thanks, Pamela, and to you and to Sanda. Just huge congratulations. It is so exciting to see such strong women at the helm of such important institutions. And also to everyone on this call, just hearing a few of you talk about the work you're doing as social entrepreneurs and the issues that you're facing was really inspiring to me. That said, I actually come to you today as a weary, determined, and hopeful American and global citizen, going through what seems like an endless election that has really exposed yet again a level of division and divisiveness in my own country that is a real reminder of what's happening in so many countries around the world. We've lost trust in our institutions, in each other, in too many of our leaders. And so the irony is not lost on me that the title of my talk is Moral Leadership in an Imperfect World, which is a world in which we all inhabit. And why I wanted to name the talk that is because not only do I think we all agree that we all need to lead differently in this moment of such extraordinary interdependence and growing fragility, but also because I've had the great privilege over the last 20 years through Acumen and the 15 years prior to that through other institutions I've created or been a part of, to work with more than 1,000 change agents, social entrepreneurs who have reached hundreds of millions of individuals. And if you asked me what it comes down to in terms of differentiating those entrepreneurs who build important, solid businesses and those who actually create inclusive models that ultimately change systems, it comes down to one word, and that is character. It's not the smartest, it's not the most connected. It is the individuals that have vision, the ability to take in feedback, and certainly resiliency and grit to take on a status quo and use business as a real tool for change. And it's an interesting time in the world to talk about business, because along with the institutions that a new generation is losing trust in is that institution of capitalism. And so for me, what is so critical is that we find those moral leaders that help us reimagine capitalism in ways that insist on putting our shared humanity and the sustainability of the earth at the center of our systems and not simply profit. And indeed, that's what I know you all stand for. By moral, it is important that you understand that I'm not talking about a set of rules prescribed from on high. Rather, I'm not talking about righteousness. I'm talking about those leaders that focus on service to others and not themselves, and that are insistent on raising the collective we rather than the individual I. I'm going to share just a few stories and really building on what Pamela said, talk about some systemic approaches I think that can help in this time of such fragility. Because as Pamela inferred, COVID has been like a heat-seeking device aimed directly at the poor and the vulnerable, and has truly exposed our gaps and our wounds in all of our systems. The first, though, is the power of business if we see it as a tool that we control rather than let it control us. Because I really believe that the market can be a powerful listening device. It's a story that starts in Ethiopia, where government had the responsibility of the chicken industry. And it's hard for government to run businesses. And I would argue that government should not run businesses. And yet government can provide extraordinary partnership, which is a whole new set of skills that we need as moral leaders, entrepreneurial leaders. So two young guys 10 years ago, Dave Ellis, Joe Shields, see this opportunity that the government was willing to privatize the chicken industry and had a 65,000 square foot chicken farm with very few live chickens. And these guys managed to raise the initial capital. They came with a lot of assumptions, including what the private sector does well and what government does not do well. And in fact, they weren't right on all of those assumptions. But they had the character to listen, to really understand how decisions are made by farmers, by agents, by consumers, by government. And they built a model that recognized that it's actually very hard to give smallholder farmers day-old chickens and expect those farmers to raise them until their egg-laying age, which was the model previously. And instead, they used an aggregator model where they built a system whereby they would raise, incubate eggs until they were one day old, sell those one day old chicks in batches of 1,000 to agents who were making this their core business, who then in turn would share would sell the chickens in batches of 2 or 3 to smallholder farmers who were making on average of about $350 a day at the time. Their initial assumption was that the private sector would be more trusted than government, and they were wrong there. That indeed in rural areas with smallholder farmers, the government of Ethiopia was very trusted. And so they had the humility and the audacity to see and understand what they did well and what they did not do so well, to partner with government who would provide this kind of training. Ethiochicken would provide inputs and capability building to the agents and to the smallholders. And our role, because the finance sector absolutely also has to change and we need new models of how we invest, was to invest long-term patient capital. Support the company, not just with that kind of long-term debt and equity, but also to support them with our networks, support them with technical assistance, help them get access to grants, which are also so critical to building truly inclusive businesses that employ and serve individuals in sustainable ways. And today, Ethiochicken in Ethiopia is a $50 million company that is serving about 20 million smallholder farmers and has been credited by government in partnership for reducing childhood malnutrition in Tigray, where it's operating by 11%. And we calculate is injecting a little bit more than 250 million into the economy every year. It's the power of inclusive business. The market, though, isn't always a listening device, as all of you know. And certainly where we've got very broken systems, if our goal is to create an inclusive economy, not just inclusive business. And if you look at coffee, if you look at cocoa, I dare say, as Pamela talked about, if you look at many of our commodities-based businesses, the market hasn't listened very well at all, certainly not to low-income farmers. Because traditionally, we've looked at global commodities prices in the way that we negotiate prices with smallholder farmers who have very little voice and aren't listened to at all. But what's exciting to me is that there's a new generation of entrepreneurs that are that's turning that model on their head. I'm seeing a lot of them in Latin America, where they're building companies in premium coffee, premium chocolate, like a company called Azahar, which starts by negotiating with the farmers based on understanding the actual production costs of those farmers, creating a sustainable living wage, insisting on multi-year contracts because they've come to understand through listening that farmers want to have stability in their income so that they can plan their own lives like all of us do. They built a community of trust, which is a word that is in too rare supply right now and is so critical to making an inclusive capitalism actually working, because they are deeply transparent with the farmers. They actually show the farmers what the coffee at the end state in my neighborhood in New York City is sold for. They bring in buyers, increasingly big buyers like Stumptown, Blue Bottle Coffee, who purchase their coffee because it's high quality. And increasingly, and Pamela alluded to this, because they know that their employees and their customers care. They want the transparency as well. And it's thrilling to me that you can make markets work and you can build truly inclusive businesses that work for the farmers, for the earth, for the customers, and for the buyers. Even if the buyers have to give up some short-term profitability, because in the long term, our corporations have to be inclusive themselves, or frankly, they're going to become irrelevant. And that's the promise of what, again, so many of you represent as social entrepreneurs that are starting small, innovating at the edges, building models, and from my perspective, becoming the new role models and the new business models for what inclusive business can really be. Because what the end game has to be that we also learn how to partner with corporations, with governments, with philanthropy to solve our toughest problems. And ultimately to redefine success away from one that too often values money, power, and fame, to one that sees success based not on how the rich and the wealthy are treated, but on how the poor, the vulnerable, the earth fare. And that's hard to do. It's particularly hard to do when so many of our systems reinforce that it's not character that puts bread on your table. The winners that we see too often are doing the easy thing, not the right thing. And yet we know long-term for the world that we want to build and must build, we need to find those individuals with the character to do what's right and not what's easy. There's no roadmap for that. Not right now. We have to build it. We have to build a collective that builds it together. And because there's no set of clear rules, at Acumen, my organization, over time, we decided to write a manifesto, a statement of values, if you will, to help us make the hard decisions. And it's a statement to which we aspire to live, even if we don't always live up to it fully in the way that we want to. And if you'll indulge me, I'll just read it. It starts by standing with the poor, listening to voices unheard, and recognizing potential where others see despair. It demands investing as a means, not an end. Daring to go where markets have failed and aid has fallen short. It makes capital work for us, not control us. It thrives on moral imagination, the humility to see the world as it is and the audacity to imagine what it could be. It's having the ambition to learn at the edge, the wisdom to admit failure and the courage to try again. It requires patience and kindness, resilience and grit, a hard-edged hope. It's leadership that rejects complacency, breaks through bureaucracy, and challenges corruption doing what's right, not what's easy. It's the radical idea of creating hope in a cynical world, changing the way the world tackles poverty and building a world based on dignity. For us, it all comes down to dignity. And if I have learned one thing, it is that we don't get dignity as a world until we all have dignity. Those leaders who are building truly inclusive businesses must be at the forefront of showing the world who we can be together. And increasingly, I believe that the change for the world has to come from the bottom up. And that starts with each and every one of us. And it means that we need not just the social entrepreneurs and the businesses, but we have to have the humility and the audacity to learn to partner with corporations, with government, to build a new kind of trust and to renew a world that needs us. So I wish you all good luck and thank you.
Thank you, Jacqueline. I think I could speak on behalf of all of us when I just say, wow. That was a very, passionate and personal and insightful presentation. We really thank you for bringing that to us today. I'm sure we have lots of questions coming up for you. We'll come back to those, but thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great. And the third speaker this afternoon, I'm very happy to welcome Sanda Ojambo. Sanda has over 20 years experience, including being head of the sustainable business and social impact for Safaricom in East Africa, and has recently been appointed the CEO and executive director of the UN Global Compact, which is the largest voluntary corporate sustainability initiative in the world. So welcome, Sanda. Glad to have you with us today.
Great, thank you. Thank you so very much for inviting me to join this forum. And it's just truly an honor to speak after two really inspirational ladies, Pamela, who I had heard speak once before, and I purpose that I must connect with her, and Jacqueline, who I've known for many years and has always served as an inspiration to me. I was just recalling, I think it was a year ago, Jacqueline and I sat in an office and we talked about moral leadership. This time a year ago, the world looked very different, but the call to action around that bold moral leadership still remained the same. And I don't know if you recall that conversation, Jacqueline, but it was certainly a very memorable one that really, I bring up every so often in my mind. So, I just want to thank the two of you for your really inspirational comments. And to the rest of you on this call, a lot has been said about the challenge and the opportunity that lies ahead of us. We are just at the beginning of, what in January was a decade of action on the Sustainable Development Goals. There was a strong call to action for concerted effort around really putting humanity at the center of everything that we do. And still, that rings true. I think we're in a moment of unprecedented and unexpected challenges that will make success even more difficult, but actually even more necessary. And this is not a new idea. I think everybody has said this, but amidst challenge and crisis, there is always opportunity. There's opportunity for reflection, opportunity for renewal, opportunity to re-energize and focus on what is truly important. And for us at the Global Compact, we firmly believe that business needs to seize this unique moment of opportunity for transformation and also for us to work together to achieve the green, equitable, and inclusive future that we all need and that we all want. I think we can also seize the opportunity to rebuild trust in business and strive towards powerful words that were stated by Kofi Annan, who was the Secretary General of the UN in the year 2000 and founded the Global Compact in that year. So Secretary General Annan stated that his vision for the Global Compact was to provide a human face to the global market. And that human face really is the root of the 10 principles that the Global Compact adheres to and asks our more than 11,000 signatory businesses and 3,000 non-business participants to adhere to. Close to about 70% of our members actually medium and small enterprises as well. And those 10 principles for us are human rights, labor, the environment, and anti-corruption. These issues are at the heart of the work of the Global Compact. And now more than ever, as we've heard from both Pamela and Jacqueline, these issues are extremely relevant. We firmly believe that human rights, labor, the environment, and anti-corruption provide a framework for sustainability and for sustainable business if they are well embedded in strategies, operations, and supply chains of companies and organizations of all sizes, irrespective of whether you're a startup company, a small, medium company, or a large business multinational. These principles provide inspiration and indeed can serve as the moral compass in uncertain times. Through this moral compass, we too aim to inspire a bold and moral leadership to navigate through these times of both opportunity and challenge. We encourage business leaders everywhere to seize the 10 principles and deliver on the sustainable development goals as a guide to responding to the current crisis. To build forward together, we firmly believe that the business community needs a coordinated plan based on these principles and indeed the 2030 agenda. You know, in many ways, when I look around at the responses that we've seen to the COVID-19 pandemic, they are firmly grounded in the sustainable development goals. Many of them have been rushed. Decisions have been made under extreme pressure. But imagine if we did not have goals to guide some of the multi-stakeholder partnerships that we've seen, goals to frame the human development issues of health, decent work, and inequalities in a way that governments, business, and civil society could come together to respond. We've seen it happen now in crisis. Our desire is to see it happen all the time, because at the center of all of this, yet again, is humanity. And I firmly believe that our collective responses will always be critical in efforts to support people and companies that are affected by the pandemic, to limit further economic disruption and ensure continued business continuity for swift recovery. If COVID has taught us anything, it's that our collective health and prosperity truly depend on working together and leaving no one behind. It has been a tough year. No matter where you are, I kicked off in Nairobi, Kenya at the beginning of the year. I'm now sitting in New York. The world has been singularly focused on one issue, the pandemic. We've been shaken by multiple crises in health, in economic and human development, and all around the world, economies and societies are reeling. As is the case, often the poorest and most marginalized people are suffering disproportionately from all of these crises. And we cannot ignore the persistence of structural racism and widening inequalities. And this really just heightens the fact that there cannot be any meaningful recovery without social justice. I think it's crystal clear that business as usual is just not enough. Business has to be involved in the business of both business benefit, but also societal transformation. And so when I joined the call earlier, it was really inspiring to see calls to action for business ranging from displacement to diet, to green growth, to managing wastes of all kind. Because the fact is, these are the opportunities that address very real challenges. And in addressing these challenges, we certainly deliver both business benefit as well as that societal transformation. I also was thinking back to all the innovation that I've seen over the last 8 months around COVID in e-commerce, in health, and in financing. And that truly must be acknowledged. We've seen a series of partnerships unusual and a very significant amount of resources mobilized. Again, we need to do that more often, not framed by crisis, but framed by responsible business and putting humanity right at the center. Challenges remain in many areas: decent work, climate, inequality, poverty. We need collective action. We need collective business action. We need political will to be able to address all of these going forward in the decade of action. You know, the previous speakers have spoken about jobs, they've spoken about climate. I just want to focus on one particular statistic here, which is the global gender pay gap, stuck at 16%, leaving women more vulnerable than ever to the economic downturn. And we've seen now more than ever, women already do 3 times more unpaid work than men, looking at issues such as childcare,
family care, frontline health work, and it's a situation that stands to be further exacerbated by the ongoing pandemic. This is a critical issue for responsible businesses and policymakers to truly address. I think that as we look forward and look at all of the economic stimulus that is being deployed, designed and deployed for countries, you know, essential first steps really have to be issues such as wage and income protection, loan and mortgage protection, universal health care. And, you know, we need to have a stimulus package that is looking at maximum effect on the real economy, not just for investors and stockholders, but supporting the micro, small and medium enterprise sectors, supporting women who play a key role in the economy, benefiting workers through equitable job creation, access to finance, provision of safety nets, and many other measures that are critical. I think it's just important to reflect on the fact that as we now become a world that is singularly focused, you know, on unilateralism, we need to really embrace the idea of getting back to a focus where the world is interconnected, where business is interconnected, where society is interconnected, and we focus in a very multilateral and broad thinking way. I know, like many others, amidst this moment of challenge and yet immense opportunity, there's a lot to process. I go back to a core principle. At the core of all of this is humanity. In short, we need to take a look at how we can unite for a better world, for all of us and for humanity. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you so much, Sander. It was a great presentation. It's great to have all three of you, if I could ask all three of you to rejoin, or maybe I need to actually invite you. Oh, there we go, rejoin. We have a few questions coming up on the Q&A. So if anyone else would like to post questions there, please do. And you can also vote for questions as mentioned before. One thing I would like to start with as a question is that you are working with sort of different sets of businesses, everything from sort of smaller entrepreneurs right through to larger businesses, multinationals and so forth, and also a lot of medium-sized businesses in between. And I wanted to get your perspective from all three of you to start, is, and tapping into something that Jacqueline mentioned before, is we do a lot of work focusing on supporting inclusive businesses, individual inclusive businesses, and trying to make individual businesses more sustainable. But how do we make sure we get this shift towards these inclusive and sustainable economies, where the actual more sustainable and inclusive businesses are the ones that win, are the ones that are more successful? How do we help make that shift? What are you doing today, and what more do we need to do to make that shift so that the most sustainable businesses are also the most successful? I'm happy for any of you to start with that simple question.
Okay, I'll jump in. For me, the start of inclusivity is really about access to finance. I just think that it's really important. You can't sit at the table if you're not resourced enough to be at the table. And I think for many businesses, it's really got to be about how can you access finance. If you look at the innovator, developer community, a lot of it is that they're not sufficiently structured enough to be able to negotiate as is. Or if you are negotiating for equity buyouts and shares, the question is, do you own your intellectual property enough to also own the ability to sit at the table? Now, if you move a notch upwards, in many countries around the world, it's just not possible to walk into a bank and ask for finance. It's practically not. How do you grow without having to, for example, as I go back to the earlier comment, selling out on your IP, selling out on your ability to effectively own and run a business. And I think this really also has a severe impact on women. As I say, women are not always able to access capital the same way that they are in different parts of the world. So for me, I think inclusivity is, you know, access to finance is just a key part to promoting that inclusive business and an inclusive economy. Just one part, not only, but I think it's a key starting point.
I always love being on a panel with Sanda. And I'm so excited about your new role, Sanda. I would agree with Sanda, and it's something that we've been working on for a long time. And I would add that what we're really focused on, Mike, are really celebrating the new role models, business models, and then the importance of sharing, not only sharing ethos, but measuring what matters. We won't truly build a new economy unless we've got the equivalent of GAAP accounting principles that actually integrate the positive and negative externalities, if you will, of our impact, negative and positive. And we've been trying to develop a set of metrics over the last decade called Lean Data, where we actually, because we want to be so consumer focused, will text 10,000 customers of a company at a certain time and ask them a series of questions from which we can deduce not only do they like the product or not, but in the case of, say, solar energy, are they staying up later? What is the quality of their light? Is the product actually displacing carbon? Are they healthier or not? So that once you've invested across an entire sector and have 30 companies as we do, we can then allocate our resources more effectively for impact, not only for returns. It's a microcosm, but there were so many organizations that saw value in this that we ended up spinning it off as a for-profit company called 60 Decibels. My dream is that this type of metric system, because this is only one kind, really becomes much more universal, and that we insist on measuring the overall impact a company creates, not only for their shareholders, but for all of the different stakeholders. And I think we've taken, as a world, we're at the first step of that.
If I could dive in a little bit. Thanks so much, Jacqueline, for what you said about, you know, the moral leadership and how important it is in our world. And Sandra, for, you know, just understanding the role of the private sector and the importance of dignity and humanity. For me, I like to take a step back, because I started out in diplomacy, and then went into development, then went into academia, then came back to development. You know, so I've kind of been all over. And one common thread throughout the entire, you know, segment of my career has been the systemic problem. We have a systemic problem, and we keep piddling around on the edges, trying to fix little things and fix MSMEs and fix, you know, the cocoa farmers and fix the problem we have. And I'll give you one of my big pet peeves. Well, it's not a pet peeve, it's actually a fundamental human problem that I have. And hopefully before I die, I'll get to try at least fix it. The issue of commodities and the fact that, you know, I come from a commodity-dependent country. You know, we're now tourism, but we were, of course, sugar and colonies and all of that. And so we spent 400 years doing this. And what's amazing to me is that 400 years later, we're still doing pretty much the same thing. Still have the big companies coming in to do whatever it is, whether it is cobalt out of Congo or cocoa or, you know, the fact that Switzerland can sell, or any of these countries that produce chocolate can sell at $40 a box. Meanwhile, the cocoa farmer gets, you know, there's a systemic problem, in my view, that the world needs to address. And until we address the fact that there's something fundamentally wrong with the dynamic, the fact that, you know, the electric vehicle is blossoming and growing in Europe and it's the biggest thing ever. I drove one for 4 years, it's wonderful. But 60% of the cobalt comes from the Congo, and we have kids in mines and they're not benefiting in any real way from this development. So how do we accept that? How do we consider that something that is not just morally right, but just humanly right? So for me, if we can step back a little bit sometimes and look at how do we bring the big companies, the big multinationals, the people who are involved in this kind of extraction, to understand that developing on the ground with building value chains and value added on the ground increases not just the capacity of that country to develop and to increase human dignity, et cetera, but it also helps them because these are also linked to issues of migration and everything else. But anyway, I'll stop there. But for me, that those are the fundamentals. So, yeah.
Okay. Jacqueline, did you want to add?
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more, Pamela, that and I do believe that one of the positives, and I can talk a lot about the negatives of technology, is that it is creating more transparency and understanding of this. To put a fine point on what you're talking about, because we work in cocoa as well, the $100 billion industry is essentially built on the labor of about 5 million smallholder farming families, 90% of whom make under $2 a day. That is not a situation that is productive, just, or moral.
Yeah.
And what I'm hoping is by building models that then create partnerships with corporations, we actually can start to lead, because I don't know if governments are going to be the first movers in actually setting the rules for systemic change. I do see a small number, but a growing number of corporations that at least want to start to work on this.
Yeah.
And we've got to work faster on this, and we've got to think more audaciously about with whom we partner. And again, it's why I'm excited the two of you are at places where you can actually help build these relationships, because it's fully unsustainable. And you could make an argument that we have to reimagine the whole financial system for at the continent level if we're really going to make significant change.
Great, thank you very much. I'm going to go from a very big question about transforming whole economies and the global economy to a very specific question we have from one of our participants, Keleda Sultana, who's with a jute production facility in Bangladesh. And it's a very specific thing. We've had no order in the last 7 months. Things are getting too tough to run my production house as well as my business. Can anyone suggest what I should do now? I don't want to wrap up my shop. And this is just one example, but we can imagine that there are many small producers out there that are really facing this at the moment. Do you have any words of advice for them?
I've been talking a lot, so I'm happy to do it. But Pamela, you're a month in, but you're working with SMEs, but I can also take this again.
You can go ahead and I'll follow you. That's fine.
I see this everywhere, and I wish I had a great answer for you. I can tell you the two things we've done, and it comes from a place of real privilege in that I've learned a lot through COVID, the power of building a community. And again, building trust. And so while Acumen has always only made loans and equity investments, it was obvious during COVID that in the countries in which we operated, there was no emergency grant facility available to our small companies. Sanda knows many of the fellows that we work with, and they are really working with the most vulnerable populations, and they themselves run very fragile businesses. And so in a way that I really found remarkable, and it's that combination, I think, of 20 years of building relationship, but also privilege, we were able to reach out to our investors and our donors and say, here's the need, trust us, and pretty much turn around. And based on the trust and the character of the fellows that we have now known for a long time, we could make decisions within a couple of days to get them the grant financing they needed so that they could essentially keep people on payroll. And it's been remarkable to me to see how that can happen. And it's also been deeply frustrating at how little it is happening around the world, where big institutions that have the capital could easily just recognize that capital is capital, and we need to put the right kind of capital out at the right time. And then second, because we're such a large investor in off-grid energy, within the first 6 months, 30% of the off-grid solar companies have stopped operating. 80% of those that continue to operate have less than 4 or 5 months of cash on their books. And so we've been working with 20 different institutions, from grant makers to investors, hopefully to close soon, $100 million concessionary debt facility for solar companies. But I think what we need right now is that creativity for not just lenders and investors, but grant makers to see the power of moving grants to those individuals they trust to hold on to the jobs that they've created.
Pamela, did you want to add to that?
Yes, actually, you know, one of the things that, one of the biggest problems we have is the fact that, as we say, there's, in, we are saying in Jamaica, more dog than bone. sorry. But, you know, I thought it would kind of encapsulate exactly what the problem is. But the issue of financing is a perennial problem, particularly for small and medium-sized enterprises, mainly also because of the issue of how we define collateral. And one of the things that we had spoken about, and I had spoken about in my previous job with Caribbean Export, was how do we help banks redefine what is collateralable, if that's a good word.
Yeah.
Part of the problem is, as I said to them, and particularly in very, very, you know, risk-averse settings. In the Caribbean, for example, we have banks with $9 billion in assets sitting. $9 billion. And they don't lend anything. And if they do, they lend at very large interest rates. Why? Because they have not learned to collateralize an idea. It has to be, you know, something that you're planting, something that you're buying, something that you're selling. So for example, I've said Facebook and Twitter and all of them would have died in the water if it were left up to our banks, because they have not understood that. So parallel to that, we work in issues of angel investing. You know, how do we get angel investors to see how, you know, how to help these small businesses? We work in mentoring. How do we, you know, attach them to bigger companies and help them to bring them along? We also work with, of course, the business support organizations within countries. So helping those business support organizations to break down the mechanics to help them on the ground, because it's hard for us, of course, to reach everybody on the ground. So there are various areas, but I think the one big missing link is helping the banks begin to understand the power of intellectual property and the fact that it is now the most important thing emerging in terms of collateral, and being able to say, well, you know what, I have this great idea. Can you help me to build it out? Rather than having to come with, you know, a piece of land or something to say, well, you know, can I borrow against this? So I think that that's an element that we need to look at.
Thank you. I have a question for Sander here. Sander, under your leadership, how are you going to make the UN Global Compact even more inclusive for the SMEs who are focused on inclusive business?
Thanks. And, you know, I joined the compact at a time when one of my first tasks is actually to develop our new strategy. And the truth is, I mean, right now, about 70% of our membership is mid to small enterprise. But I fully understand what the call here is. The call here is what do we deliver? What is our value proposition for the enterprises? There are global challenges, I think, that are universal. You know, climate change is one of them. The gender challenge that I spoke about. But I think what I hear, and I hear from constituents, and I hear from potential businesses, and certainly something that we're very alive to hear at the Global Compact, is that some of the challenges that you know, MSMEs face here are very, you know, they're down to a couple of fundamental issues: policy and regulation. What is the framework around you know, a micro business and how they operate? Again, the access to financing challenge is massive. You know, sustainability therein, you know, once you're in as a small business, you know, what mechanisms can you put in place to buffer, as the person who asked the question about the jute business earlier. So we're very aware to the fact that perhaps some fundamentals around, you know, good, sustainable and responsible business for the MSME sector is very important. And it's something that we are taking a keen look at as we develop our new strategy. I think it's just important to be responsive. A few months ago, we launched in partnership with UNDP a COVID-19 facility that is really aimed at re-energizing and reinvigorating the MSME sector. We started off in 4 countries with this facility that aims to first provide that access to financing, provide technical assistance, provide a platform for, should I call it matchmaking, how to create visibility of the existing pool of businesses to potential other partners who might not be in that immediate ecosystem, but are able to relook at how they can rebuild supply chains, perhaps more innovatively. How do you really cushion and build resilience across supply chains? This might be providing support backwards and forwards into your supply chains, because most often with global supply chains, your suppliers are across, not with you, they're in countries far off. So this is something that we launched, and we're in the process of really developing that proposition, as I said, in partnership with UNDP. But for us at the Global Compact, I think our new strategy will aim to be very alive and robust to some of these challenges. And also to partner in ways that we're able to really understand the sector and deliver for them.
Great. Sounds like you've got some great plans in the works. So thanks for that. Another question here. So we talked a little bit about, social entrepreneurs and smaller businesses. And we've talked about that there are a handful of sort of larger businesses that are keen to be at the forefront of being sustainable and really lead the way and become role models in sustainability. But what about the rest, all those in between, all those medium-sized traditional businesses that have been running, and they're running a sort of a solid business over perhaps many years? How do we actually get them to shift to become more sustainable? It might not be that finance is the answer for them. It might not be what they need, but how do we get them to shift? How do we incentivize them to actually change, to actually be more inclusive and more sustainable? I open that to anyone. I'd be happy to answer. Pamela, you're muted.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I think the fundamental issue with most, traditional firms or firms that have been around a long time is fear. If they change what they've been doing, which they've been fairly successful at, and they take on these new sustainability issues, will they sink? And I think where we come in, people like Acumen, like Global, is to show them how including these new sustainability models, looking at green competitiveness, looking at incorporating, solar power as opposed to relying on fuel, fossil fuel. Show them how it can actually increase their profitability, have them grow, and have them access new markets. Until we do that, there will always be a hesitancy and a reticence to move to a new area. Why? Because it's natural. You've been doing this for, 50, 100 years. There are a lot of family-owned businesses that are small businesses. And so they've developed, a winning model. And to shift to a new way of doing things requires them to be convinced in a way. And so that's why we work with the business support organizations in these countries. It's why we also work with banks and we work with women-owned businesses to try to translate this new model of working into something that says, you can succeed in this new dynamic. This is what you need to do. So in working from at the very, low level, from developing their business plans, working on how they can increase market access, looking at their production systems, all of that, the entire value chain of their work, so that they can see that it can work for them. That's one of our ways of doing it.
Thank you. We have a question for Jacqueline here. All the companies that you've invested in, what do you estimate being the percentage that are NGO-driven social enterprises versus more commercial solar enterprises, what the IFC calls IB initiatives? Or do you even make that distinction, and what is the breakup in that case?
We do make that distinction, and I would say very few, less than a handful on the investing side of the work that we do. The one NGO that stands out, operates like a business, it's Arvind. I help iSystems in Madurai, India, which essentially took a just-in-time approach to delivering eye care. Mm-hmm. And they treat about 5 million people every year in India. And they have a business model whereby if you are wealthier, you pay market price, and if you're very poor, it's free. They consistently create profit that allows them to sustain their operations, and they have a manufacturing for profit that they own underneath it that continues to move it. I think it's a spectacular model, and it's all too rare. But otherwise, every other investee for Acumen is a for-profit.
We have another question here. I think you've partially may have answered this question, but maybe you can add a bit to it, Pamela. This is coming from Costatine in Tanzania. Most of the SMEs are informal and young, facing many challenges like credibility in the market, less information about their business information, and lack collateral, all which we've talked about. All these discourage banks to give loans. How do you handle this situation at the ITC? And I can add a little bit to this is that, you know, a lot of these smaller businesses also go for grants, but that's also very competitive and challenging. And there's very few that actually know how to navigate that. I mean, how do we get these smaller businesses there? Sorry, you're muted again.
Okay. There we go. we have two programs. I think my mom would have liked that button.
Yeah.
We have two programs, one on the Youth and Trade program, and also the other one is She Trades program. The Youth and Trade program, we've been working with a lot of young startups and entrepreneurs and young people, one, to help them actually navigate the space of getting grants, of, you know, making a business case to a bank, of, you know, building their internal capacity. So we work at a granular level, trying to help them develop that capacity and therefore make themselves more sellable, you know, if that's the right word. And in the She Trades program, I think we're now present in almost 20 countries. We launched the last She Trades program in Trinidad last Wednesday. And that's specifically focused on women-owned businesses. And thus far, it has been a phenomenal success. We have, I think, almost 2 million women already looking at going into markets or already connecting to external markets. And through that, we've offered grants, we've worked with the local organizations, we've worked with businesses to help them help women. So essentially, if he can contact us or you know, contact his BSO in his country and see how we can work together, we'd be more than happy to do that, you know, because we do want to help small startups and informal, you know. The truth is, most of us in developing countries are informal. I mean, people talk about the form, but it's the informal sector that actually drives a lot of our economies. So we have to find a way to work with them. And we do that mainly through the organizations on the ground. So that's one way, if he can do that, that would be very, it's in Tanzania, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
So we have a question from Emily Schultz from the Ethical Trading Initiative. What is your opinion on legislating CSR? Is this the way to go to push companies to take more responsibility, or should it be voluntary? That's open to anyone who's willing.
I'll jump in. You know, I used to work in this field. In my previous role, I sort of used to go to work and run two foundations as well as run the sustainable business field. But, you know, also had the opportunity to interact at a global level and engage in the CSR debate. And, you know, my first thing about philanthropy is it has to be rooted in values. I think that the minute it becomes a compliance or legislated issue, you get into a tick the box thing. And we've seen countries and examples where, you know, there is a compliance approach to CSR, and it truly has demonstrated that it's not a fundamental shift. It's not a systemic issue. It's a, what is the bare minimum we need to do to get by? So, and I know it may reap some benefits to those in need, because certainly, you know, philanthropy does target people with very basic needs. But I have a fundamental challenge with CSR and philanthropy being a compliance regulated thing. Mm-hmm. I've evolved in my career, I really began to then truly appreciate the transformational role that business can play in just taking a more sustainable development approach to their business, and perhaps just reorienting the entirety of their business operations to deliver more on these development agendas. But I also acknowledge that in significant parts of the world, you know, philanthropic responses have a significant role to play. And I certainly, we've seen that through COVID. I think a lot of the initial responses have been purely philanthropic. But, you know, my view is that, you know, corporate social responsibility should be grounded in a moral response to critical business issues and get it done. I worry about the compliance element to it.
Thank you. I would just add, I couldn't agree with Sanda more that I think CSR in many ways lets us off the hook from what we were talking about before, which is actually shifting the entire system so that we evaluate businesses' effectiveness based on the true impact that they're having on environmental resources, on the employees that they either use or empower, and their customers and their shareholders. And so I'm much more interested in the whole integration. But Sanda's point about moral leadership is, again, so important. And that goes to partnership as well. I know Sanda from when she was running Safaricom's foundation, and it seemed like everything else at the company. And when we partnered, it wasn't, here are some philanthropy, go create a fellows program. But rather the questions that we would ask each other was, how can we build the next generation of leaders in East Africa in ways that actually support Safaricom's work and their team, as well as using their team to support the next generation of leaders in East Africa? And it's this reorientation of ourselves as not only in community, but of community that I think is so critical, and that that Sanda and really the whole team at Safaricom modeled, and we need more of these kinds of partnerships.
Great, thank you. I have another question here from Christian Jan, from our friends at the Inclusive Business Action Network. Thanks to all three speakers, great input and passion for inclusive business. I also like the idea of Jacqueline and celebrating inclusive business and the leaders who support them. Why don't we organize an international event next year to bring those hidden champions to the forefront? This could also be the beginning of a more structured exchange on a global level. Who would be interested to co-organize such an event? I'll put my hand up for that as well. Any responses to Christian on that one? I don't know if it's so much of a question, but an offer.
It sounds like an offer. I would just say that a lot of those leaders, it seems to me from what I was seeing before, are here.
Yeah.
And the fact that the participants were so enjoying talking to each other, with all respect to we, the panelists, that Mike, it seems like it's also a call for more of that. And then the only other thing I would say is Acumen typically invests in for-profits, but many of our fellows run in nonprofits. And the older I get, the more I don't really care what the structure is, whether it's a for-profit or a nonprofit. The question is it the right structure for the problem that you are trying to solve? And are you solving it in a way that is unabashedly sustainable into the long term?
So we're almost time to wrap up, and all the participants have some meetings scheduled in 4 minutes. So I just would allow you to have any final words, so just maybe 30 seconds each.
Okay, I'll start. I would be very excited to work with you all more, with Xander, Global Compact, with Acumen, because I believe it's very important for us to not just have the SME programs as you know, singular programs, but connected to businesses, connected to other value chains. So for example, one of the things that we'd love is if bigger companies could include these smaller companies in their value chains, work with women more as well, procure from women-owned businesses, procure from young businesses. That way you build, and that's what I'd like to see more than anything else. So that's my 30 seconds.
Thank you, Pamela. Zander.
Happy to go next. I think it's been great, you know, being with you for the last, I think, hour and a bit. Time has truly flown. Fantastic discussion, great questions. I'd say to the people here on the call, you know, keep your eye on the real problem. I think I saw that there in what you were doing in your calls to action. I think no action is too small. And I think from everything that I saw over there, we're on the right track. It's leaders like yourselves, and we do need to create some of those fundamental shifts and challenge the orthodoxies that have brought us to where we are today. So keep at it. Thank you.
And I would just add what a remarkable opportunity it is to be on this panel. And Mike, hats off to you for putting it together and having three women, because I do have to walk away thinking we need more women leaders. I just got to say that. And the only final thing I would say, and it goes to the woman with, or the person with the jute, is that this is a very dark time in the world. And yet it's in these dark moments where we have the chance to find our best selves. And to really hold to that. And to know that that a big piece of it is to find community, to find those other individuals and cohorts that can help us do what we might not be able to ever imagine doing by ourselves. And so my hope is that this dark time leads us to a deeper understanding of what we can be together. And I wish you all good luck.
Yes, let's hope for that. And let's work on it. So thank you all to all three of you for both your individual presentations. And I think it was great to have the three of you together on this panel, sharing not only your perspectives and the work you do, but some very sort of personal messages as well. So we really, really appreciate that. On behalf of Inclusive Business Sweden, I'd like to thank you and would like to be happy to keep channels open with you in the future as well. So thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you. Thanks. Bye.
Fiona, welcome. Unmute yourself and feel free to share.
Yeah, I think it's, I'd just like to express a really deep, sincere thanks to you and the team for what was an incredible event, not only from it having all of the challenges of being online and trying to manage multiple platforms. Also, I think your moderation was fantastic, seeing as you stepped in at the last minute. So I think you really pulled the day together and made it feel very comfortable and flow really nicely. And just from that sense of, I really felt that all the people that I engaged with today, whether it was through call to actions, listening to the panelists or my one-to-one meetings, they were exactly the right people in the room. And so I just wanted to commend you on finding and marketing this to the people that should be in the room. And I think we will all share the same values and visions, yet have such different perspectives. And so I think I've learned a lot today, and I'm going to definitely continue a lot of the conversations. And so this was a very valuable use of my time and my day. And so thank you for all the effort behind the scenes for it.
Great. Thank you very much, Fiona, for your flattering comments. And so I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all the participants for today. Particularly, I would like to thank, obviously, the speakers. I mean, I don't know about you, but I was really blown away by all six of the speakers, both in their presentations and in the panels. Really amazing people who have done amazing things and were willing to take times out of their busy schedules to share with us today. So. Fantastic. Thank you to the speakers and to the, of course, the hosts of the call to action. And I'd also like to thank my team for pulling together a great day. Annika, Daniela, Emily, and Victoria have been working very, very hard on making everything work and go smoothly today. And it really has gone smoothly. So thank you to all of you for the great work and making it happen. There's a lot of work that goes into the background of setting this up, and we reached out wide and far to make everything work, and it really came together in a very nice way. So thank you very much. Also a big thanks again to our partners and funders, funded by the European Regional Development Fund, Vestry Optolandsregionen, and with support from RISE and Johannesburg Science Park. So thank you all for making it a great day. Please feel free to connect with us, you know, follow us up on all the through our website and on our social media channels and so forth. We are very open to collaboration and look forward to connecting and working more with all of you. Only 10 years left, and we've got a lot of work still to be done. So thank you, everyone. Let's go out and do it now. Thank you.